اي نعم. With pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagavan, dear brothers and sisters, thanks Swami for making it possible to meet once again. And I also come to know that all these Sai pearls of wisdom are very well received the world over. This encourages us very much to continue further. And I promise you that we'll continue. And as you have some homework there in Bangalore, I too have sufficient homework over here. Because those things have not been published, I have with me some record of Sai's conversations right from the year 1998, published by Boyce. But that, if read directly, may not mean much to us unless we have some explanation. With special reference to the context, we will not be able to get into that idea. I look into that and do sufficient homework during the coming vacation. We have few points to mention which could not be covered yesterday. Well, this is an episode from Mahabhagavata. There is one character by name Sisupala, S-I-S-U-P-A-L-A, who is known to be arrogant, violent, and a man of all vices, with total hatred for God. He was trying to face Krishna. He was trying to defeat Krishna, the Almighty. He went on attacking him, calling him by names, criticizing him, but Lord Krishna just smiled. He didn't react. Further he said, I will tolerate 100 of your mistakes. 100. Very charitable God indeed. 100 mistakes I will tolerate. If you cross that, you will be finished. So keeping up to his word, he waited Sisupala to commit 100 mistakes. At the end, when he committed 101, he beheaded him. How did he do that? He sent a wheel, electronic, which is full of mantra, that can travel at high speed, which came closer to Sisupala, taka, cut off his head. At that moment it so happened, the blood came out like water spring or fountain, fell at the feet of Krishna. That is the funny thing. Sisupala is an idiot, a violent stupid. But his blood falls at the feet of God. What is the inner significance behind it? And here, Bhagavan explains clearly the character of Sisupala. As I told you earlier, Bhagavan will raise the level of every character. He will never allow any character to be viewed low and mean. He says, Sisupala is a good man. Swami, Sisupala is a good man? Yes, he is a good man. Then why this rivalry with God? Why this hatred with Krishna?
Baba explained, Krishna married Rukmi's sister, much against his pleasure. That was the reason for Shishupala's total hatred of Krishna, as Shishupala expected to marry Rukmini. There was no other reason for him to hate Krishna. Therefore, Shishupala was not a bad person.
This really made me very much feel surprised at it. How Bhagavan can take any role from our mythology into heights, which he alone can do it. Then, I would like to draw your attention to this next episode, where Bhagavan gave clear-cut instructions to hostel wardens of Prashanthi Nilayam campus. What did he say? The best way you can please me is to take care of the boys well. The best way to please me is, to serve me is, to feed the boys very well. Serve them good food. Serve as much they want. And then, tell boys not to waste food. Tell boys not to waste money. Waste of money is evil. Time waste is life waste. They should not waste time. They should not waste their energy. They should not waste money. They should not waste food. And then with a smile he said, if boys are happy, Swami is happy. Know this point and conduct accordingly. And he further said, don't compare yourselves with outside world. No. We have our own principles of values like truth, righteousness, peace and love. Let us follow our own principles. We should not compare with anyone. That's what Bhagavan said. Further he told wardens, serve potato to our boys. Potato has lot of starch, so they'll put on some weight. And then he turned to postgraduate students. Boys, you'll be completing your course very soon. Go home. Your parents educated you. You are brought up by your parents till now. It is time now for you to serve your parents. You have to take care of them. You must please them. You should earn their blessings. That's what Bhagavan said. My friends, you'll agree with me when I say there are none in this world today who can speak to students in this manner. Is there any teacher anywhere telling boys, take care of your parents, serve elders, please your parents? Who will tell like that? Baba, the Godfather, can only do it. In the meantime, some person came, elderly man, a responsible man, came from behind, closer to Swami, and said something, whispered into his ear. Bhagavan said, you don't need to tell me anything. I know everything. Where do you think I am? I am everywhere. Why do you tell me? You don't need to tell me, I know. All of you remember one thing. Who taught fish to swim? Nobody taught. Similarly, nobody need to teach me or tell me. I am born with these powers. I know everything. No one need to tell me anything. That's what Bhagavan said. Then I come to the next episode. A sort of instruction to teachers and boys. Teachers, be alert. When you put a question, see whether the boy is responding properly or not. He gave one funny example. It seems one teacher was explaining in the classroom. And finally, he said, "All that I said, my boy, did it get in?" The boy said, "Sir, everything got in, excepting the tail behind." Tail? What does he mean? At that moment, one rat was moving in the classroom. And that rat was trying to escape out of the classroom. It got into the hole in the corner. Everything got in and the tail is left behind. So when the teacher asked, "Oh boy, all that I taught you till now, did it get in?" "Sir, everything got in excepting the tail." So you should know, watch carefully. There's peals of laughter. Everybody burst into laughter. And he said, "Boys, I get number of letters from you, but there are many spelling mistakes. There shouldn't be spelling mistakes. You should be very careful. And in pronunciation, you should be very good. Our boys should speak good English, good spelling, good accent, good pronunciation." And Swami gave one example. One little boy was practicing spelling. He got up in the morning, practicing, repeating the spelling of the word milk. Spelling of the word milk. Mother was cleaning utensils outside. When this boy was repeating the spelling of milk, she ran into the room asking, "Boy, what happened? What's wrong with you?" The reason is this. The spelling of the milk is M-I-L-K. The boy went on repeating M-I-L-K, 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 M-I-L-K. Yalaka means rat. E-L-U-K-A, Telugu word, Yeluka, meaning rat. M-I-L-K, 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 Amma, mother, rat is here. That's what she thought. In fact, this fellow is practicing the spelling of the word milk. M-I-L-K. So Swami said, you should be very careful as you do that. And further, Bhagavan also said, "Boys, I want to tell you that you should have the individuality, integrity, honesty that will bring you everything in this world." My friends, recently, 3 days ago, a professor from California, Department of Economics, he gave a talk in our institute. I reported to Swami what had happened. He made a survey of about 2,000 students who have undergone Sachisai Education in Human Values training program. And these boys who were trained in Human Value program settled very well in life later when compared to other boys. They were absorbed in leading companies because of their sincerity, honesty, hard work, work culture. And the professor from California said, This is the living proof that success high education, human values, ensures prospects right here. It is not taking you to paradise after death or heaven. No, no, no. Right here. Therefore, Success High Education Human Values Training Program is really fantastic. It is in this context I should draw your attention to what Swami said to boys, that they have got to be men of integrity, honesty, sterling character. And then he gave one example. Look here, boys, 40 years ago, or at least 30 years ago, or even more, Bhagavan happened to be there in Bangalore. And he was passing by the Indian Institute of Science was there in Bangalore. He was traveling in his car. There is Indian Institute of Sciences there in Bangalore. You must have heard of it. Indian Institute of Sciences there in Bangalore is internationally known for its standards. And many of the professors are Bhagavan's devotees. Swami visited that campus and he was going in his car one day. He saw a student standing under a tree in the midday, with a long, serious face. Long, serious faces upset Swami. Long, serious face is allergic to Bhagavan. He wants smiling faces. That's why he always appreciates foreigners. They always have necessarily smiling faces. Serious faces are an exception. All of them smile well. Swami will see their faces. That's what Swami will always say. So, Bhagavan was upset watching that young man at this age with a long, frustrated face and all that. He stopped his car. Hey, boy, come here. Why are you like that? Swami, I appeared for an interview just now. There they have put some questions. I could not answer them. They asked me to get out. I am badly in need of a job now. I am very much disappointed. I pleaded with the director to consider my application once again. He said, first get out of the room. I am helpless, Swami. Swami took pity on the boy. You do according to my advice. Swami, I will do it. Okay. How did you come here? Swami, by a bus. Did you spend your own money? No, Swami. How did you come here? Traveling allowance was paid by the institute. So with that money I could reach here. Is that money enough for you, or still you want? Swami, they have sent enough of money. Still balance of 8 rupees is still with me. Oh, I see. Now I'll tell you now. He told that boy, boy, stand there only. Director of Indian Institute of Sciences now will go by this side in his car. You say, sir, sir. Then he will ask you, what do you want? Get out. You are not eligible for job. He will tell you like that. But tell him, sir, I have not come here for a job. You paid me 20 rupees towards my traveling expenses. I spent 12 rupees. 8 rupees balance is still with me. I am waiting here to give you back that balance. you tell him, then you will see. Swami simply left the mysterious God. As expected, the driver saw, right, get out first. No, sir, balance I have come to give you. Director said, such boys we want in our institute. Such boys of honesty and integrity we want. Come on, join duty this afternoon. Okay. And Swami stopped his car at the end of the road, watching this boy. This fellow ran. Fell at his Swami, I got the job. Yes. When you follow my command, when you follow my principles, when you have the character, integrity, you will get job anywhere. You will be successful anywhere. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, he looked at one student there, who is working for his PhD, doctorate program. He said, boy, what are you doing? Swami, I am doing research. Oh, okay. How are you doing your research? Swami, very nicely. Have you started writing your thesis? Dissertation? Yes, Swami, I started writing. What are you writing? Swami, I am writing all that you have said. You are not supposed to write all that I say. You have got your research guide. You should act according to the instructions of the research guide. You should not write whatever I say in your thesis. Know that. And then looked at that boy and said, at the time of the wedding, priest is there. Priest gives instructions. But it is only the bridegroom who will put the wedding ring into the ring finger of the bride, not the priest. Priest won't put the wedding ring. It is only the bride and the bridegroom who exchange their rings, not the priest. Similarly, I am only the priest, sir. You should have information from your guide. You should follow your guide. That's what Bhagavan said. Why speak the last episode of this series? While speaking of the divinity, the awareness which is present everywhere, I was tempted to put one question. Swami, is there any path to know awareness and divinity? Is there any definite path to awareness? Baba said, when there is a path, there must be name and a form. But divinity is beyond name and form. So there is no path to divinity. The only thing is realization. If you know that, that is sufficient unto itself. There is no path. That's what Bhagavan said. With that, we come to a close of the series relating to that period. Now I pass on to the next one. January 2001. For information, these months correspond to the months of Telugu Sanat Sarathi magazine containing my own articles covering these conversations of Baba with students. So no one has any copyright. No problem. Don't worry about it. I really wonder why people want to have these copyrights unless the other person is interested to misuse. To prevent misuse, one can have a copyright. But actually speaking, God is free. Nature is free, message is free, you should be free, and I am free. No, Christ has no copyright on Bible. Krishna has no copyright on Bhagavad Gita. For one book I want to have copyrights. What Himalayan ego I have. Will anybody be of any help to me? But I am not against that. Sometimes copyright is necessary to prevent misuse, so that others don't misquote you. That may be necessary. Well, now, let us know a few episodes of January 2001. It was the episode 1. It was the time of sports meet. And boys were preparing for sports meet every morning, jogging and different items, and jumping and all that. And Swami commented one evening, "Boys, look here. Two are necessary to be successful. What are they? One, enthusiasm. Second, commitment. Enthusiasm and commitment, these two are necessary for anybody to be successful. Now, if you have mere enthusiasm without commitment, you will be a failure. You have commitment without enthusiasm, surely a double failure. Therefore, enthusiasm and commitment should exist hand in hand, leading to a thumping success in life." Then he said, "Boys, for anything in this life, you need concentration. Without this, you cannot achieve anything." And then Bhagavan said, this applies to everybody. When you do anything, do it with full concentration and attention, without thinking of what others are feeling about it. Don't go by others. Do it all by yourself, with full concentration. You should not be bothered of others' impressions and opinions. And further he said, when one's ego finds a place in you, you lose your concentration. We know sports and meet, sports and games meet everywhere. Who will convey this message to boys? Who will convey this message to youngsters? As I told you before, every occasion, every situation is an opportunity grabbed by Bhagavan to convey his divine message. Then, next day, he looked at a boy and said, "Are boy, yesterday evening I saw you. You are wearing red shirt and jumping around." "Jumping around. I know." That boy looked at Swami in all surprise. How does he know? Then he said, "I know your colors, how you change your colors. I know you in your true colors. I know you in your true colors because I am everywhere." That's what Bhagavan said. And in the same context, I can also bring your attention another instance. Most of you must have attended sports meet. There at the commencement, they'll have a big, massive mascot or a big vehicle. that will be in the front, which will be taken to the hilltop. You must have watched with the help of a wire. Have you not noticed it? Mascot. And usually they go to Swami, take his permission and blessing to prepare the mascot of the year. And the boys took number of pictures, many drawings, asking Swami to select the best. Please believe me, it is on record. Without looking into any picture, Swami went on telling that, this, this, that, all the 10 names he said. I don't have to see, I know what pictures you have drawn. All right, for this year you have the tiger as your mascot. For this year's sports meet, that's what Bhagavan said. In this context, I happily remember what Rama Brahmam of Bangalore said to me, which will be a piece of information to every one of you that would serve as a guideline. It's also noted here. What did he tell me? Mr. Anil Kumar, note that Swami will come to know as you start writing on paper. Never doubt whether Swami knows or not. Never think that whether Swami has gone through your letter or not. He comes to know as you hold your pen and start writing on the paper. It is very much true. These are instances that fully support what he said. And then some boys from Vrindavan happened to be here. Swami asked the boys, what are you doing? The boy said, Swami, we have gliders. We fly high, 5,000 feet above the sea level. We fly. Oh. How do you fly? And one boy said, Swami, there are trainers there in Bangalore. He tested our students, selected few of them, gave them special training so they can fly. Then Baba said, good. Test is very necessary. Test is necessary even in spiritual life, because test is God's taste. Test is God's taste. Don't grumble. Do not complain that God is testing you. No. Tell God, oh God, I welcome your test. Please test me very soon. Why? So that you can promote me to a higher class next. Oh God, I know that it's not possible for you to promote me without testing. So test is a must. Therefore, I welcome those tests. So I pray to you that you test me sooner than what you wish. That should be your temperament. Then I started shivering my shoe. Swami, I am not prepared for the test. I'm sorry. If there's any back door, I'll try to manage through the back door. I don't want test. Baba said, no. No. You teacher, don't you test your students? Do you give marks like that? Doctor, does he give prescription without testing the patient? So test is a must. You cannot avoid it. Why do you want to run away through the back door when there is a main door? Walk through the main door. don't find an escape to run away through the back door. That's what Bhagavan said. And even if you manage to run away, the so-called benefit you get is a temporary. That's all. Be careful, he said. Then, when that Bangalore boy was telling, Swami, we fly high, 5,000 feet above the sea level, he looked at me and said, Anil Kumar, can you fly? Swami, I cannot. I very well remember flying at a height of 500 feet, not 5,000. 500 feet or 250 also, I don't think so. At that height, Swami, I had full concentration, total prayer to God, unwavering mind, steadiness of faith, born out of total fear of life, Swami. Everybody laughed. He said, what happened, Swami? All boys said, sir, you should also go up. In gliding, what they do is, you will be tied to a rope, and there will be a canopy on the top behind. And there will be 300 feet rope connected to a jeep. The jeep will run in the front. Zzz, start going to I felt so bad. Why do these idiots unnecessarily ask me to fly high like that? I was thinking of my family and children, everybody. And then the man in the jeep could know my feeling. He told me, don't hold your that point tight. No, just leave it. Don't, nothing will happen. But I was holding tight. He could watch my feeling from a distance. So he slowed down the jeep and I could be brought back safely to the ground. I told Swami, that is enough. I don't want any more. And then he said, look here. You said your head was reeling. If you have really steady faith and true devotion, it will not happen. Swami, I don't have. Please leave me. That's all. And your worldliness is responsible for that fear. Understand. But look at that boy. He could easily fly high at 5,000 feet high. Height. Why? He was with me for the last several years. He has been staying here all through. He never went back. So that gave him courage and conviction that made him fly so high. Because he knows pretty well that Swami is by his side, that nothing can happen. Oh, okay, Swami, that is true with that boy. For me, enough. And then he turned to Prashant Nilayam boys and he told them, boys, I saw you on motorcycles. But I tell you one main principle. Swami knows motorcycle. I don't have to ride the motorcycle. But I know I will tell you the secret. What he said was, what you are doing is, you come at a high speed in the beginning and slow down towards the end. It is not proper. You should be slow in the beginning and fast later to win in a motorcycle race. Oh, Swami is leaking some information to the boys so that they may win in the match. And then Swami said, alright boys, look here. As a student in my school days, I always stood first in the running race. I was always first in the running race. Who are other competitors? Big boys, taller than me. But I stood first. You know why? Those big boys start running very fast in the beginning. Later they get exhausted. They start gasping for breath. whereas I start slow. Pick up speed, chak, chak, chak. Good, good, good. And stand first. This is the secret to win. That's what Bhagavan said. And then, Bhagavan was in a reminiscent mood. Boys, when I was there in Kampala, you know, Swami visited Africa. When I was in Kampala, I saw many giraffes with tall feet and walking very fast. Giraffe can walk faster than a car. That Swami noticed there in Kampala. But zebra walks very slowly. You are not zebras. You should be like giraffes. That's what Swami said. Well, this episode relates to some other day. Swami came to the college that morning and saw boys marching parade. He saw all boys doing marching. One school after another, one batch after another, passing the dais. Swami was noticing. We thought the Swami was happy. But in the evening, he told everybody, for proper marching, training and discipline are very necessary. And while teaching this marching, the trainers should be very tough with students. They cannot be lenient towards students. They should be very strict. And then Swami said, what happened to him in those days while he was in Kamalapuram? There is one place by name Kamalapuram in the district Kadapa where Swami studied for some time. Swami said, in my school days, there is one drill teacher who was very strict. When anything goes wrong, he will cane the boys. He will whip the boys. Very strict. And if parents come and complain, why did you beat my son? The drill teacher will say immediately, you have sent your sons to be trained by us. If you don't want this training, take them home. The modern teachers are very lenient. Therefore, children are not able to learn anything from them. That's what Bhagavan commented. And he also said, how to march? Swami is speaking on marching. He says, you should not bend your legs while in marching. And hands should swing freely on both ends. When you put one leg forward, the hand should go backward totally, because it's marching. Left, right, left, right. So the hand should move freely. That is proper way of marching. And Swami said, there are two styles of marching. British marching and German marching. And the method adopted in India is British type of marching. So you should do it perfectly. And while in marching, the heel should just touch the ground. It should not totally touch the ground. Just like that. That's what Swami has shown to boys there. I'm not acting in front of you. This action replayed. That's all. So it just touched that. That he was showing what to do, what slow marching is. And when Swami was speaking about marching, hand swinging and all that, the trainers, army people, they lifted their eyebrows and watching Swami. Does Swami know marching? Oh, I see. But my friends, we should know. Sai is awareness. Awareness is total understanding, not little fractional, segmental knowledge. In fact, Swami will make the whole world march left, right. Why should we think that he does not know marching? So he knows everything. Another day, Swami had been to primary school. He saw boys' program and he was commenting. Look here. Primary school children will always do in the best way possible. Why? Children are highly devoted. You fellows, you are not that devoted. Because age, muscle, ego. But little children, they have no ego. They are very good, innocent. Then, you boys, you are more concerned about the outcome of the program. Whether it is going to be successful, thumping success, you concentrate on the result. But the little children, they look at Swami and start doing everything. And that gives them all the success. So understand it. Therefore, your programs are not that interesting as the programs of the primary school children. That's what Bhagavan has said. And then he told boys, see those children, they have no fear. They can climb anywhere like monkeys. They can do, whereas you fellows, you have got a lot of fear. You know what? Napoleon, Churchill, you know how courageous they were? You know how brave they were? And in fact they said, be clear, rest will follow. Be clear, rest will follow. Meaning, if you have got clear idea of what you are supposed to do, success will necessarily follow. That's what Bhagavan said. So, boys, without any fear, be courageous and brave. Sports meet for that year, 2001, concluded. And Swami granted interview to all military trainers who came here all the way to train our boys. Now, there are 9 trainers. I see you listening to me in rapt attention. Bhagavan waved his hand like that. 9 watches are metallized at a time. 9 at a time, dara. All the 9 of them. And he started distributing 1 each. And then, everybody, that is Baba. And he gave 1 each. And started cutting jokes. Then, while saying bye to them, 9 rings at a time, dada. He gave them 1 each. Correct fit to the finger of every one of them. That is Bhagavan Baba. Then I said, Swami, I am so happy to report to you that all are praising our boys for their wonderful performance at the sports meet this year. Then Baba said, don't get yourself bloated. Don't let yourself carried away by the praise. Let the people praise you or blame you. If your conscience is satisfied, that is enough. That's important. That's what Baba said. You should not be elated when you are praised. And you should not be depressed when you receive blame. Then Swami, I am not capable of that. I feel very much pained when people blame me for no fault of mine. I feel a little bit encouraged when people praise me naturally. After all, I'm a human being, you know. When you say, Mr. Anil Kumar, you're doing a good job. Good. Good. I feel encouraged to do little more. But on the other hand, if anyone says, what is it? It's not up to the mark. I feel discouraged. Swami, then Baba said, there is nothing like good and bad in this world. What is good to you may be bad to the other man. What is bad to the other man may be good to you. So how can you consider other man's opinion? Don't think like that. And then Swami gave one example. It seems marriage function was to take place at a residence, while on the other corner there is a farmer who is waiting for the rainfall to sow the seeds for the harvest, for the crop. This fellow, preparing for the wedding, is praying to God, "Oh God, let there not be rain tomorrow because of wedding function at my residence." Whereas the farmer, agriculturist, staying in the corner of the other room, other street, the corner of the same street at the end, that fellow says, "Oh God, let there be heavy rain so that I can just sow the grains here, so that this field will be ready, so that I will have the crop enough to eat." So one is praying for rain, one is praying for absence of rain. Let it be dry, full sunshine. That is his prayer. "Oh Swami, very good example you have given. Therefore, what should I do? Because it is not good to you, shall I stop praying to you? Can't I pray for that which is good to me?" That's what I said. "No. Swami, what should I do then?" Baba said, "Pray for everybody. If you pray for everybody, your wish also will be fulfilled. There will be rain satisfying the agriculturist. At the time of the wedding, there will be no rain so that your wish is also fulfilled. But if your prayer is absolutely selfish, everywhere it will be dry. Right on your house there will be downpour of rain. So that wedding function will be a failure. So always pray for the good of everybody, so that your wish also will be fulfilled." Then I said, "Swami, it's very satisfying to note that all these military people who have come here, they found this place very good. They have fit into this system very easily. They found themselves very convenient here. They could fit into our system." Baba said, No. "Our system made them fit to stay here. They are not fit enough to stay in the system. It is the system that made them change, that made them fit to stay here." Then he looked at me and said, "Prashantinilayam is a big workshop. All these cars come here for repair. I repair them, send them back. So there's no problem." "Oh, I see. Swami, last question I have." "What is it?" "Swami, now that Bangalore hospital has come up there, many people are telling that you will be staying there in Bangalore for more time than what you have been doing till now." Swami said, "I did not tell anybody like that. Why do you spread rumors like that?" "I did not tell anybody. But look here, Anil Kumar. Whether I am here or there, wherever I am, I want all of you to be happy. I want all of you to be very, very happy. I want all of you to be peaceful. That's what is important for me. Because I may be physically there, but I am spiritually everywhere. That's what Bhagavan said. With that, that month, 2001, comes to a close. Om Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu Om Shanti Shanti. Jai Bolo Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba Ji Ki Jai.